Try that again. Is Grace here?
No, Professor Mike, there are some changing the place. The Grace is shifting to last day. Now it's Dr. Mohammed Al-Sirahi from Kingdom Saudi Arabian. Okay. He is joining us in this. Welcome, Dr. Mohammed, to be part of last session, except our apology to take you late, but I know you are supporting our conference.
لا بالعكس. اولا السلام عليكم ورحمه الله وبركاته. اسعد الله مساك اختي العزيزه دكتوره هنادي، والشكر لك موصول لهذا المحفل العلمي الرائع صراحه. اي نعم، بس اتمنى ان لا اكون انا اطيل على الاخوه الكرام في هذه الامسيه. تعريف بسيط، اخوكم محمد سريحي، خريج اكاديميه الطيران المدني عام 1988. ما ادري في ترجمه فوريه دكتوره ولا
Excuse me, Professor Mike. Dr. Mohammed, he will speak in Arabic, but the translation will be available in Zoom. Okay, and also we make a translation, a quick translation on the slide. Accept our apology. He preferred to talk in Arabic. Accept our apology, Professor Mike and the other speakers. You can turn the channel to be in English. Go ahead, دكتور محمد.
أوكي. طبعاً خريج البكالوريوس إدارة عامة عام 1988، والماجستير في إدارة الأعمال، والدكتوراه في إدارة الأعمال قسم الموارد البشرية. ورسالة الدكتوراه كانت تتحدث عن الإبداع والأداء على موظفين الملاحة الجوية، حيث كنت آخر منصب لي مستشار أكاديمية الطيران. طبعاً تحدث الإخوان جميعهم عن الإبداع، عن التطور، عن الثورة الصناعية، عن الذكاء الاصطناعي، ولكن احنا نبغى نتحدث عن هذا الإنسان، هذا المورد البشري، هو الذي صنع هذا الابتكار وهذا الإبداع. فدوما أنا أقول غايتي، طبعا عضو أنا في مؤسس المركز المؤسس والمجلس العربي للإبداع والابتكار وملتقى المبدعين في الثقافة السعودية. طبعا لو سأل الإنسان نفسه، هل سألت نفسك يوما ما هو الإبداع؟ هل الإبداع موهبة؟ هل هو مهارة مكتسبة؟ هل الإبداع موجود بداخلنا ونحتاج المحفزات لاستخراجه؟ وهل الإبداع الآن أصبح ناتج قومي وجزء من الاقتصاد؟ طبعا نعم، الإبداع هو الآن أصبح صناعة وليس عبارة عن هوى أو هوايات أو رغبات، إنما هو عبارة عن صانع وناتج قومي يؤثر في الدول. لذلك أصبح الآن خسارة الوطن العربي من عدم استفادة من عدد من المبتكرين والمبدعين 11 مليار، والآن في السبعينات، والآن قد يصل إلى 200 مليار بسبب نفوق أو خروج العديد من المبتكرين إلى دول منها أمريكا، أستراليا، شرق آسيا، أوروبا، لعدم وجود البيئة الملائمة للمبدعين والمبتكرين. طبعاً إذا نظرنا لمعظم الدول الآن، أصبح الاقتصاد الرقمي أو الاقتصاد المعرفي هو له الأثر بالاقتصاد المعرفي، ومنها دول أوروبية العديدة، منها فنلندا وغيره من الدول، ومن الدول العربية أيضاً في جانب الدول العربية، الإمارات، قطر، السعودية، من هذه الدول التي اهتمت بجانب الاقتصاد المعرفي، لأنه أصبح الآن هو الاقتصاد في نمو الأوطان. نرجع لموضوعنا، صناعة الإبداع. إذا تحدثنا أنه الإبداع هي صناعة، هل الإبداع مهارة مكتسبة أو قدرات فطرية أو ظرف مفاجئ؟ تعريف الإبداع، عناصره، سماته، تنمية الإبداع كيف، المعوقات للإبداع، كيف نصنع مبدعاً، ونماذج من المبدعين على مستوى. فإذا تحدثنا عن الإبداع كفطرة، عدد من العلماء تحدثوا أن الإبداع هو عبارة عن فطرة مكتسبة، والعدد منهم قال هي مهارات تكتسب عبر التعليم والثقافات وعبر الممارسات، والبعض منهم تحدث أنه قد يكون الإبداع هو يأتي فجأة، وعدد من العلماء والعباقرة لم يكن لديهم تلك الطفرة، ولكن عندما مروا بظروف معينة صنعت منهم تلك المبدعين أو تلك المخترعين. ومن العلماء الذي تحدث عن هذا الجانب أيضا العالم زايلوكس كيري، الذي تحدث أنه جزء من تكوينات الدماغ تجعل للإنسان لديه عدد من الجينات الموروثة، لذلك بعض العلماء أو المبدعين أو المبتكرين يتوارثون أيضا في نموذج قد نتطرق إليه، ألا وهو العالمة الإشعاع الفرنسية ماري كوري. كانت هي عالمة في الفيزياء والكيمياء، وأخذت جائزة نوبل 1903، وأيضا زوجها بيري كيري ولهم من الأبناء اثنين بيار أيضا حصلت على جائزة نوبل. لذلك قد يكون هناك توارث للجينات وقد يكون مثل اللاعبين مثل المشاهير المطربين قد يورثون ذلك وقد لا يورثون. ومن أقوى النماذج نيوتن عالم الذي أثبت للعالم القوة والجاذبية ولكن لا نرى امتداد له أحد من العلماء. إذا حبينا نعرف الإبداع كظاهرة فالعديد الإبداع ذكروا كظاهرة أنه الإنسان يجد نفسه الإنسان البداية أصنع العربة من الدواليب العربات من الأحجار صنع الرماح من الحجر أيضا لتلك المادة أو تلك هي تلك الأحجار وتلك الصخور صنع منها ما يتكيف مع حياته في تلك الفترة. الآن الإنسان طبعا بعد ثورة الكمبيوتر في العام 1960 في بداياتها والثورة الصناعية الرابعة هنا خلقت للإنسان العديد من الابتكارات الثورات الصناعية التي احنا نعيشها والآن التطور وأيضا الثورة الصناعية التي نعيشها وهو الذكاء الاصطناعي وأنظمة المحاكاة وكما يقال الحاجة أم الاختراع. ولكن الآن نقول لا هناك عوامل هناك بيئة هي المؤثرة. والبعض يرى أن الإبداع هو رؤية غير مألوف بالأمور المألوفة ولكن أنا أقول الإبداع هو عبارة عن فطرية نرثها وتكون لدينا بمواهب وقدرات متميزين عن الآخرين إضافة لها مهارات مكتسبة هي التي تزودنا بتلك المهارات التي تصنع منا المبدع والمبتكر والموهوب والعبقري كيفما. فلو تحدثنا عن الإبداع يعتبر قدرة عقلية تظهر على مستوى الفرد والجماعة ويستطيع أن يطورها الإنسان والجماعات وتتحدث عن عدد من الجزئيات البسيطة التي تتكون من إذا ذكرنا من هو المبدع. هو إنسان لديه عدد من القدرات ألا وهي الطلاقة الأصالة الحساسية مرونة درجة مخاطرة. فهذه الكوكبة من القدرات التي ينتمي لها أو يتمكن منها الإنسان تصنع منه ذلك الإنسان الذي يكون متميز عن غيره موهوب ببعض الأمور. قد تجد موهوب بجانب الأدبي أو جانب الرياضي أو جانب الفلسفي أو جانب الغناء والموسيقى والعديد من النماذج. فتحدثنا عن الطلاقة، ماذا تعني الطلاقة؟ ألا وهي القدرة على إنتاج أكبر عدد من الأفكار وهي جزء مهم من تكوين الإنسان المبدع. ويتشارك في الطلاقة الموهوب والمبدع والمبتكر والعباقرة ولكن يختلفون بالأصالة ألا هو إنتاج المألوف. والأصالة هو أنك تأتي بفكرة لم يسبقك فيها شخص من قبل. والمرونة وهي عملية كيف تعالج مشاكل كيف تخترع الحلول كيف تجد مخارج لبعض الأمور. والمرونة أيضا هي من يصنع منك التفكير خارج الصندوق كما يقال الآن هي عبارة عن عنصر المرونة. حساسية إذا وجدنا إنسان يتحكم بجزئيات من فكره تلك هي الحساسية قد يراها جون وديفيد وعلي ومحمد ولكن إنسان يأخذ بباله هذا الشيء وحاول يطوره أو يدقق به النظر ويحاول أن يجد له العديد والعديد من الأمور. وأيضا درجة مخاطرة هناك من لديه جراءة بأن يقتحم. إذا رأينا مثلا مبتكرين في صناعة كلاشينكوف عندما صنع تلك الآلة التي هي كانت قد يكون سيئة ولكن هو ابتكر شيء في درجة مخاطرة ولكن الآن أصبح جزء منه يستخدم كجزء أمني أو يستخدم أجزاء سلبية. أيضا التركيز الانتباه دوما الإنسان المبدع والإنسان المبتكر يركز الانتباه ويحاول يعمل فوكسين أو تسليط الضوء على جزئيات بسيطة جدا جدا قد لا يعتذر بها الآخرين أو قد لا يهتم بها الآخرين. ولكن الإنسان المبدع لا بالعكس يكون على قدر. أيضا الإنسان المبدع والمبتكر لديه القدرة على تحليل الأمور يرتبط بأمور سببية يرتبط بقواعد يرتبط بأمور لماذا هذا الأمر حدث ولماذا هذا الأمر وما هو الرابط ما بين A و Z. فيحاول إيجاد تلك العلاقات التي تربط أو نقول عبارة عن تحليل تلك المواقف. أيضا الإفاضة الإفاضة هي أيضا الاستزادة بالأفكار التوسع والعديد. هذه تقريبا هي الأساسيات خلق أو صناعة الإنسان المبدع. سمات الشخصية السمة إذا أردنا أن السمة هي الكاريزما التي تتكون من ذلك الإنسان في أمور نلاحظها بالنظر إنه هذا الإنسان ذكي سمارت لديه تريست الثقة بالنفس أيضا لديه الأهداف تحقيقها قدرة كاملة على تنفيذ الأفكار لديه الإيجابية دوما الإيجابية كما قال الطاقة الإيجابية والتفاؤل. محال أن نجد إنسان مبدع لديه قصور، محال أن نجد إنسان مبدع سلبي. على العكس، الإنسان المبدع تجده إيجابي ودوما يصنع من الألم الأمل، ومن عمق الزجاجة يخترع ويبتكر. أيضا عدم الرضا، دوما الإنسان المبدع يتمرد على البيروقراطية، دوما يحاول أن يكون إنسان متفتح، إنسان يفكر خارج الصندوق، لا يحب العمل. أو دوما تجد الإنسان المبدعين ومبتكرين يتنقلون بين الأعمال، ولكن يجد أعمال أفضل وأفضل إلى أن يترقى ويجد ما يغري، أو ما كما يقال يغري شغفه أو يرضي غروره. أيضا الإبداع هو جزء عدم الخوف، ودوما الإنسان المبدع لا يرتبط أو لا يؤمن بالفشل مهما. عندما سألوا أديسون صانع المصباح الكهربائي الذي نحن ننعم بهذا الإنارات ونوع، فقالوا له يعني أنت أخطأت تقريبا 990 مرة، لكن قال أنا تعلمت الخطأ أو تعلمت العديد من الحلول 990، ولكن المرة الأخيرة هي التي وجدت الإجابة الصحيحة واستنار العالم بما صنعه أديسون. إذا تحدثنا كيف ننمي الإبداع، كما قلت القدرات الآن أو العالم اللي نعيشه أو الطفرة الثورية أو الطفرة المعلوماتية هي عبارة عن تنمية الإبداع داخل الإنسان. نجد إنسان في بلد فقير وفي بلد غني وفي بلد مضطرب وفي بلد مستقر، ونجد الإنسان في بلد اقتصاد نموه عالي وفي اقتصاد متدني، ولكن تنمية الإبداع تعتبر على هذا الكائن البشري. وجدنا العديد من الشخصيات، أستضيف مثلا ساندرا بيتاشي، شاب هندي من أسرة صعبة الحال، ولكن مواليد 1972، انتقل لأمريكا عام 1993 بمنحة دراسية، الآن يتربع على كبرى الشركات مايكروسوفت وجوجل، ورئيس تنفيذي خلال فترة لا تزيد عن 12 سنة. يعني عمل في شركة جوجل 2002 وترأسها 2015، خلال العشر سنين أو خلال العقد صنعت من هذا الشاب من أسرة فقيرة رجل يتخطى على إمبراطورية كبرى الشركات في التقنية. أيضا إذا تحدثنا عن تنمية الإبداع، هو إيمانك بأنك لديك القدرة وأنك لديك الفكر وأنك تستطيع أن تغير. الأحلام، دوما الإنسان يكون متطلع ويحلم، يكون لديه الأمل بأن هناك غدا أو هناك استشراق أو هناك استشراق لمستقبل ينتظره. ولكن إذا كان الإنسان يرى الجانب السيء من حياته، فهذا ما يدمر العديد من لديهم قدرات ولديهم فكر إبداعي. أيضا دوما الإنسان المبدع لتنمي الإبداع لديه لابد أن يغير نمط حياته. البيروقراطية في الحياة أو الروتين المتكرر لابد يتغير. أيضا حرصه أن يكون لديه عمل يقوم بملامسته، عمل يكون جزء إبداعي. لذلك قد نجد شخص وشخص يقومون بنفس العمل، ولكن شخص يعتبر العمل هذا عبء عليه والآخر يتفنن ويمارس العمل. عديد من الموسيقيين نجد بالآلاف، ولكن للآن نتذكر الموسيقار بيتهوفن والعديد والعديد. لماذا؟ لأنه صنع من الموسيقى عالم آخر، ولكن مئات أو آلاف الموسيقيين لم يدونهم التاريخ. أيضا الاهتمام، إذا أردنا أن ننمي الإبداع، الاهتمام بتعلم الألعاب الذكائية والتي تساعد على التفكير، أيضا قيام بجدولة الخطوات. دوما الإنسان حتى الأطفال لديهم القدرة، إذا أعدت ترتيب حياته، إذا خلقت لديه الفكر ترتيب إدارة الوقت، أيضا هذه من ضمن المنظومة التي تصنع الإبداع. أيضا البعض منهم يدون ملاحظاته، أنا ماذا يعني فعلا يسوي فولو شارت، أول يوم أنا أبدأ بأي، غدا أريد أن أصل إلى زد. لديه مراحل يسجلها، وليس عيبا تسجل، ولكن ليسجل. وهذا ما نراه أحيانا، البعض منهم قد يرى موقف يسجله ويصنع منه أفكار، يبني أفكار. قد يرى إذا أردنا أن نعود من صنع الكرسي المتحرك أو غيره، تجد أنه إنسان تفكر في جزئية معينة للأشخاص الذين ديسيبل أو الذين لديهم عدم القدرة على المشي، وصنع من هذا الفكرة. وهناك العديد والعديد من الأساليب التي تساعد في تنمية الإبداع. أيضا هناك طرق وتمارين، منها العصف الذهني، منها القبعات الستة، منها لعب الأدوار، أن تفكر أنت بالعديد من القضايا بمنظورك وتفكر بمنظور الإنسان الآخر ماذا يراه. لذلك دوما لما نحكم على بعض الأمور بشكل سيء، نحكم بنظر محمد، لا أحكم بنظر محمد وصالح وجون وديفيد عشان تتأكد وترى لديك العدد من الرؤيات، وهذا أصدق أيضا. إذا تحدثنا عن
محمد، محمد we're way over time here. Can you try to wrap it up in the next few seconds? Yeah, we're way over time.
Okay. We have many time for the category. Farooq Albaz, this is NASA, Brittany Stephen Hawking, this is inaccessible people, but now famous in physics, Philphysia. أيضا زهرة من العراق، أيضا مهندس معمارية زهى حديد، إبراهيم الفقي in كندا، in HR إدارة الأعمال التنمية البشرية، رشيدة اليزمي مصنعة البطارية الليثيوم، مشاعل الشميمري لديها مصنع في أمريكا فيرجينيا صناعة الصواريخ للسلام للمركبات الفضائية والعديد والعديد. ولكن دوما إذا أردنا أن نصنع الإبداع فنصنع الفكر، لابد قبل أن نصنع التقنية. شكرا. Great. لن أطيل عليكم. أتمنى
Thank you very much, Mohammed. I'm sorry I have to cut you off, but I've got these other papers
to get in. I know this is late
to
and too late now.
Yeah, thank you very much. There's a lot of comments I was going to make on this, particularly when you pointed out some of the characteristics entrepreneurs need: intelligence, confidence, determination, positivity, and no fear of failure. I thought were very, very key points that you made. So thank you very much. It was certainly an excellent paper. I wish we had a little more time to listen to more of it. Thanks again. The next paper is Dr. Abdullah Aldarba here. Okay.
Abdulrahman.
Sorry. Who's next?
Excuse me, Professor Mike. I'm so sorry. Maybe you have still not updated agenda. It's Abdulrahman, Mr. Abdulrahman. I'm so sorry, Professor Mike. I will send you. I will send you now the updated agenda.
My
Mr.
fault.
Abdulrahman,
I'm sorry.
Who will take? I'm so sorry, Professor.
Okay, no problem. So you can do it in about 10 minutes. So thank you.
Fadal, Mohandis Abdulrahman.
Thank you, Dr. Hanadi. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. طبعاً راح أتحدث باللغة العربية. بداية أشكر القائمين على هذه الفعالية الثرية، وأشكر بشكل خاص الدكتور هنادي على كريم الدعوة. أسعدني المشاركة مع هذه النخبة والاستماع للنخب منذ بدء المؤتمر. إضافات علمية وعملية مميزة. فقط أود تقديم موجز عن وضع وتوجه المملكة في ريادة الأعمال وتثقيف المجتمع حولها ودعم رواد الأعمال. فريادة الأعمال في المملكة انطلاقا من سعي المملكة العربية السعودية إلى رفع إسهام القطاع الخاص في الناتج المحلي الإجمالي إلى 65% وزيادة نسبة الصادرات غير النفطية من 16 إلى 50% من إجمالي الناتج المحلي غير النفطي وتخفيض معدل البطالة إلى 7%، نجد القيادة تحفز وتشجع جميع القطاعات والمنظمات، القطاع الخاص والقطاع العام والقطاع الثالث، العمل على بناء مجتمع المعرفة والاقتصاد المعرفي من خلال ثقافة ريادة الأعمال. وقد تضمنت رؤية 2030 توجيه الدعم المباشر وغير المباشر في ذلك، مثل هيئة دعم المحتوى المحلي، ومن أهم أدوارها تطوير فرص المحتوى المحلي وتمكين المنتجات المحلية. أيضا بنك التنمية الاجتماعية، والذي لا يقدم الدعم المالي فقط بل يعمل على تأهيل وتطوير رواد الأعمال بدورات وورش عمل. أيضا الهيئة العامة للمنشآت الصغيرة والمتوسطة منشآت، والذي له دور فاعل وإسهام ملموس في دعم الاقتصاد السعودي عن طريق توفير جميع الاحتياجات الخاصة بالمنشآت الصغيرة والمتوسطة ورواد ورائدات الأعمال لإيجاد بيئة عمل واعدة تتيح فرص الازدهار عبر تقديم الخدمات الداعمة وفرص الأعمال المساندة لنمو قطاع المنشآت الصغيرة والمتوسطة وتعزيز قدرته التنافسية حتى لا يتعارض مع الاستثمار الأجنبي. كل هذا أدى إلى تطوير بيئة الأعمال. إشارة من تقرير المرصد العالمي لريادة الأعمال أن المملكة حققت صعود سريع من المرتبة 42 إلى 18 ضمن تصنيف مؤشر.
I have the wrong agenda.
بعد دخول السوق المحلية، لافتاً إلى أن المملكة واصلت تقدمها محققة المرتبة العاشرة عالمياً في مؤشر الأنظمة والتشريعات الحكومية من حيث الضرائب والبيروقراطية.
Okay. Did you send it to the AT&T or the Stockton?
No, I sent it to
اضافه لان
حق I'll open it right now. Okay.
Yeah. المرتبه 19.
All
right. اضافه حققت المرتبه 17 في مؤشر حاله رياده الاعمال بعد ان كانت بالمرتبه 41. لا شك بان التحول الرقمي الذي تشهده المملكه على جميع الاصعده ومبادرات تمكين المراه ودعمها في الوظائف القياديه وكذلك رياده الاعمال وتطوير التشريعات والقوانين كلها عوامل ساهمت بشكل رئيسي ومباشر لتطوير بيئة الأعمال وجعلها بيئة جاذبة وحفزت الابتكار خصوصا في الخدمات والإجراءات بشكل ملحوظ. أيضا مؤسسة مسك خصوصا مسك الابتكار برنامج تسريع الأعمال بالشراكة مع 500 شركة هذا الذي قدمته قبل سنتين حيث شارك في البرنامج فريق من المستثمرين والمشرفين محترفي النمو التسويقي لنقل معارفهم وخبراتهم خلال فترة البرنامج الذي امتد 16 أسبوع كما تقوم باحتضان المشاريع الناشئة ليست في المملكة فقط أو الخليج في الشرق الأوسط وشمال أفريقيا. أما إذا تكلمنا عن ريادة الأعمال في محور التعليم فقد عززت المملكة مكانتها في محور تعليم ريادة الأعمال بالجامعات وذلك بتقدمها في 19 مرتبة عالميا بحسب تقرير المرصد العالمي لريادة الأعمال GEM محقق أيضا المرتبة 23 في عام 21 مقارنة ب 42 في عام 2020. أيضا قدمت تشجيع الجامعات لتقديم مسارات مادة أساسيات الابتكار وريادة الأعمال والتي تهدف إلى نشر ثقافة ريادة الأعمال والابتكار في المرحلة الجامعية. أيضا إطلاق منشآت بالتعاون مع وزارة التعليم لقاء لتعريف مبادرة دعم الشركات الناشئة الجامعية التي تهدف إلى تفعيل دور الجامعات في منظومة ريادة الأعمال وإيجاد شركات ناشئة يكون لها إسهام ملموس في دعم الاقتصاد السعودي ويسعى البرنامج إلى تفعيل التعاون مع مراكز ومعاهد ريادة الأعمال كذلك استهداف مشاريع التخرج ومشاريع الأبحاث والأعمال مراكز الأبحاث في بعض الجامعات كأنها الورق ويركن أو يؤرشف أما الوضع الحالي يجب أنه تعكس على أرض الواقع بمشاريع وأعمال أيضا صممت برامج لخدمة ريادة الأعمال مثل مسار ناشئ وهو مسار يستهدف المشاريع الصغيرة والناشئة بسقف تمويل لا يتجاوز 300 ألف ريال سعودي ما يعادل 80 ألف دولار أيضا مسار آخر خريجين برنامج يستهدف عدد من الأنشطة للمختصين من حملة الشهادة الجامعية والدبلوم بالمجال بسقف تمويل لا يتعدى 500 ألف ريال سعودي كما أقيمت شراكة مع وزارة التعليم في مبادرة ريادي وهي أحد مبادرات برنامج التحول الوطني 2020 المنفذة في وزارة التعليم تهدف إلى إكساب الطالب مهارات سوق العمل وترسيخ ثقافة ريادة الأعمال وتحفز على العمل الحر والاستثمار من خلال عدة من الأنشطة مثل عمل دورات حدد فكرة مشروعك لطلاب الثانوية عمل لقاءات مع قصص نجاح لمشاريع من ريادي كل منطقة عمل زيارات للمشاريع الخاصة للرياديين لتعزيز روح العمل الحر للطلاب أما في الختام نحن ضمن مجموعة أصدقاء الاستراتيجية كذلك مجموعة قيادات رأس المال البشر الخليجي نحاول المساهمة والمشاركة في تنمية بلداننا ومجتمعاتنا سواء بتصدير الممارسات الناجحة أو استيرادها خصوصا بين دول مجلس التعاون الخليجي وهي منافسة اقتصادية متكاملة متبادلة أيضا إيجابية ليست لعبة شطرنج فليس فيها الرابح أو خسران لها أثر متعدي لكل الدول المعنية وفي الختام أشكر الجميع للاستماع. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's the end of the second paper. I think I have the correct agenda now. I have Glory, and I'm going to mispronounce this. Enyim Naya.
Yes, I'm here.
Did I pronounce that close to correctly?
Well, I'll give you an A minus. Yeah.
Thank you. Please proceed. I'm sorry.
Okay. All right. Okay. Please let me know when you can see my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes. Yes, okay, we can.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Glory Eninaya. I'm calling all the way from Lagos, Nigeria, and my talk is on institutional entrepreneurship in the platform economy and emerging market perspective. So digital platforms are really big, especially in Africa. Digital platforms continue to expand at a robust rate, with South Africa having the most platforms, overtaking Kenya, while overtaking Nigeria, while Kenya experiences the fastest growth in platforms. Homegrown platforms represent more than 80% of total, but data suggests that foreign platforms are capturing most of the market activities. Now, talking about the types of platforms that we have in the country, on the continent, for online shopping, we have platforms such as Jumia, Takealot, and Konga. Jumia is one of the first Nigerian companies to be listed on the New York Stock Exchange. Freelance platforms such as Snopit and VConnect. For online shopping, we have Jumia Food, we have Uber Eats. Other kinds of platforms are Expedia, Eventbrite, Bookings.com, Airbnb, which is very popular around the world, Travel Stats. For e-hailing, we have Uber, Bolt, and then for logistics, we have OFood and Pizzeria. So this should tell you that even that the platform economy in Africa is growing in leaps and bounds, and is even though it's an emerging market, but it's beginning to take over the rest of the world. Now, however, despite this growth, there's a challenge of legitimacy in Africa. So ease of doing business is not great. There's a lot of volatility and ambiguity in government policy, and this has implications for business survival. So on the right, you can see headlines of different news headlines that have made the headlines in Nigeria. I don't know how many of you have been following the news. Twitter was banned in Nigeria for a while by the president. Yeah. Cryptocurrency has been banned as well. Bitcoin, you know, the foreign exchange fluctuations. So the question is, if you're an international platform player and you want to come into Africa, what do you need to do in order to survive this hostile institutional environment? What you need to do is you need to become an institutional entrepreneur. So what is an institutional entrepreneur? An institutional entrepreneur is a change agent. Institutional entrepreneurs are synonymous with change agents. They use their social skills to overcome skepticism and persuade others to believe that their accounts, they advance about their innovations. They are socially skilled actors who work to justify and legitimate new kinds of social arrangements. They are culturally competent actors with strong practical skills who work to establish new social arrangements. So what are the strategies that institutional entrepreneurs use? They start by articulating a vision. As many of us might be familiar with the change management literature that talks by John Cotter, that talks about articulating a vision, mobilizing allies, mobilizing resources. Institutional entrepreneurs use these same mechanisms, but they use them in the entrepreneurial field. So they start with a diagnosis, then a prognosis, and a motivation. They mobilize the allies through stakeholder identification, storytelling, and then they mobilize resources such as financial resources, formal authority, and social capital. Now, starting with diagnosis, the institutional entrepreneur starts by telling a story as to why the existing conditions in the industry are not sustainable. And in that way, they expose problems with current institutionalized practices. They find a way to subtly and politely point fingers at the parties that are responsible for the negative status quo. Then after the diagnosis, there's a prognosis. So they come up with a story that casts their project or business as being superior to previous arrangements. They delegitimate existing institutional arrangements and those supported by opponents. They legitimate to stakeholders and other potential allies at the project at hand. They come up with a theory that explains the institutional project in such a way that it resonates with the interests, values, and problems of potential allies. However, the institutional entrepreneur has to be careful not to characterize his project as too radical in order to forestall reactions of fear, incomprehension, or apparent irrelevance that might inhibit potential allies from changing their perspective. Then the institutional entrepreneur also has to motivate by providing compelling reasons to support the new vision. They need to imaginatively identify with change targets. They need to have sufficient social skills to be able to map his position vis-a-vis the position of other important stakeholders in the field. They need to craft visions that other actors are inclined to endorse. They need to frame proposed changes as being mutually beneficial and introduce themselves as a neutral broker acting on behalf of the common good. The institutional entrepreneur needs to beware of the self-promotion paradox. They can't be seen to be championing their initiative at the detriment of the common good. So they need to present their project as altruistic or, you know, nest it in some kind of institution with standard structures and stable rules. They need to motivate actors to alter their perspective in a way that inclines them to mobilize behind their vision and justify divergence from taking for granted practices and frame the vision for that change in a way that enables others, despite its unfamiliar nature, to understand and endorse it. So those are the strategies under articulating a vision. Now we'll look at mobilizing allies. How does an institutional entrepreneur mobilize allies? He identifies key stakeholders, protagonists, antagonists, and other actors that might be involved in the project. Then he defines and redefines the project's identity in such a way as to attract others and build a sustainable coalition. He brings together allies in such a way as to reduce inherent contradictions in the coalition. So when you bring in people from different points of view, you know, you might find that there are conflicting interests. So the institutional entrepreneur needs to be able to empathize with the allies, but then come up with, have strategic skills so that he's able to bring everybody together without without causing any disharmony. The institutional entrepreneur also needs to use discourse and storytelling. So you need to be skilled at communicating a vision that mobilizes allies. Use rhetorical strategies when communicating your vision, you know, connect your innovation to familiar templates, use the language that is popular in Africa or, you know, wherever else you're trying to institutionalize your innovation. Build your discourse based on institutional logics, which will resonate with the values and interests of potential allies. You should use the institutional vocabularies, which are structures of words, expressions, and meanings that can help legitimize your vision for change. Use stories to create a plot and then define heroes and villains, which can subvert the established order, and then introduce himself and his project with narrative styles that are calculated to resonate with key stakeholder groups. So those are the strategies under mobilizing allies. Now, finally, we'll look at mobilizing financial resources. Institutional entrepreneurship is demanding, and so it requires a lot of financial resources. The institutional entrepreneur needs to have the financial assets to meet and bypass the sanctions likely to be imposed by opponents of a proposed change. Needs the financial wherewithal to ride out the negative costs of the transitional period during which the new ideas are likely to be unpopular. So if it's a startup, the startup doesn't break even immediately. So you need a nest egg to keep you afloat until the business is adopted by the general community and becomes publicly acceptable. You might need to use your financial resources to bring other players into a coalition, and then you need to have the financial resources to encourage important stakeholders to favor your project. Then you need to gain formal authority. You may need to gain the support of the states to make changes in your industry, whether it's the federal government, the local government. You need to find out what are the regulations and get in line. You also need to have some form of formal authority to implement changes in your industry. And then you need to earn social capital. You can gain the social capital from alliances with high status organizations that can leverage their status to impose changes in your industry. You can use your social capital to influence others who are enlisted as allies. You need the social capital to champion and orchestrate collective action among diverse stakeholders. You can also present yourself as a neutral broker, mediating on behalf of the mutual best interests of different groups, and then secure the endorsement and support of central actors, professionals, experts, technocrats, and governments, and gain access to the resources that they control. So in a nutshell, to review again, the three major institutional entrepreneurship strategies are articulate a vision, mobilize allies, mobilize resources, And then each of these strategies have tactics that, when applied, can make it possible for platforms to digital platforms to succeed in Africa. So thank you for listening, and thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Gloria. That's, I thought, was excellent. You brought up some, I thought, some very key points. Usually we don't try to stress too much about an entrepreneur's social skills, but I think, as you pointed out, those social skills are needed to reach some of the goals. The other thing, when you talk about financial resources, I know when I'm teaching new entrepreneurs, I have they have a very difficult time accepting when they raise capital, particularly early on from angel investors, they have to give up a chunk of the ownership. And I find that some new entrepreneurs are not quite willing to give up as much of the ownership that's required. I try to stress to them, the angel investors particularly are taking a very big risk. And in order to compensate them for that risk, it's very early stage, to compensate them for the risk, you're going to have to give away a big chunk of ownership. I know of three or four instances where some entrepreneurs that I've done some consulting with just simply don't understand this, and they have a tough time. And I tell them, look, a half of a huge piece of pie is a lot better than 100% of a little piece of pie, but they can't quite grasp that as quickly as I would like them to. So thank you very much. I found this to be very important.
To put it another way, 10%, 2% of Facebook is better than 100% of, you know, a startup that's not going
anywhere. MySpace. Yeah, that's exactly right. If we can just get the students and the entrepreneurs to understand that, I think that would increase the probability for success for them. Again, right. thank you very much. I found that to be very, very informative.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm not sure if I have one or two papers left here, Hanadi, so I'll just move on. Dr. Iglika Kirilov, and again, I hope I pronounced that properly too.
That was perfect, Professor.
That was perfect? Oh.
Yes, perfect. Well, fantastic. Thank you.
I'm one for two then. That's not too bad. Please proceed.
Thank you very much. Just let me share screen. Is the presentation possible? Final slides possible?
Yes.
Great. Fantastic. Thank you. So, first of all, let me share that I'm so grateful and honored to have the chance to be part of such an enriching global event with such an experienced and distinguished audience. So, thank you, Dr. Hanadi, so much for having invited me, and also for holding such an extraordinary event. I'm really enjoying it, truly enjoying it. The global learning that is happening here. It's really awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And thank you also.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to see you. Thank you. Professor Basler, also thank you for facilitating our session. So I'm Iglika Kirilov, and I'm an Innovation 360 licensed practitioner. I'm based in France. I will be showcasing here the evolution of an entrepreneurial ecosystem, and will be highlighting some key elements or moments, let's say, in the evolution that could be eventually of interest to consider when entrepreneurship is taught and innovation would be taught. And I already detected from previous presentations certain elements that would kind of fit the practitioner's perspective while working with either startups and entrepreneurs or other more established businesses. So since relatively recently here, we have been observing the emergence of multifaceted ecosystems operating in the intersections of various innovation industries. And this type of innovation multidisciplinarity aims in a way to support startups ecosystem radical potential, let's say, even further. And more specifically, this approach allows for combining, for instance, intellectual property strengths with research and development and business model innovation, and supports developing a global market reach. But the challenge here is, of course, the high level complexity that needs to be handled dynamically as the ecosystem value proposition has to be delivered and the ecosystem model reaches viability. As Innovation 360 founder and CEO, Magnus Penker, put it in his latest book, Play Bold, a possible way to get through this complexity and dynamic challenges are values. And he wrote that today's ecosystem are growing organically around values, not products and services. So a way of thinking, acting, and interacting is needed that would help to lead the ecosystem development. The story of a company called Edamame shows some shared moments with the understanding that we start the ecosystem entrepreneurial journey with our own values, beliefs, and also the level of consciousness about them. And Edamame is a young company that stands for the structuring of the world's food knowledge. They're operating at the intersection of food, data, and health. And as Victor Penev, the CEO of Edamame, explains, their truly bold vision here, Edamame's goal is to help people live up to 120 years without ever getting a chronic or mental illness. And they believe that food is a part of the solution because in their view, food is the ultimate medicine. Typically, Edamame started from the personal passion of its founder for both technology and cooking. But the way the startup value proposition development and the ecosystem development were grounded stands deep in the founder's values, beliefs, and attitudes for conscious giving, sharing, and helping each other. And the founder's engagement here for helping people brought him to treat both potential customers and teams with an equivalent human-led attitude. And interestingly, actually, Edamame's team operated in a distributed fashion long before we hear about something called COVID-19, right? And actually, they never had any doubts on employees or contributors' productivity. And today, they are covering, the team actually is covering 10 time zones across the globe with free working hours, a great level of flexibility, and a significant level of personal responsibility engagement and, permanent mutual support. So the team members, contributors, and partners deeply share the inception values and have been, in a way, attracted organically on one hand, but also purposefully recruited and involved to ensure the values delivery daily in a way. So this is in line with research findings about the significance of internal alignment of ecosystem actors. And this internal alignment is considered as being required for achieving the success of the ecosystem value proposition, especially in the context of radical innovation. So almost 11 years later, the conclusion is that so far, there has been no change in the values themselves. And Edamame purposefully, sometimes throughout their journey, took a central role in building their ecosystem. And since inception to global partnerships that they are having today, they have been expanding their ecosystem for the same set of shared values, which they have been continuously deploying both internally and externally. And this makes them a typical example of a radical innovator, focal actor, having the central innovator's role of orchestrating also the process of ecosystem integration and realignment so that the ecosystem value proposition is consistently delivered through the ecosystem model. So standing strongly behind these inception values, beliefs, and the levels of consciousness and walking them with the required praxis is somehow blurring here in this example, the lines between organic growth and orchestrations. They have been performing both at different stages and they are combining them instead of opposing them. So to assume the leadership role, they started with one of the most significant challenges for ecosystem leadership, which is sharing the vision to attract actors for genuine collaboration, well articulated around values. And naturally, the accompanying actions were boundless interactions. And the involvement of new actors led to the need to set up the resource flows among ecosystem members. And the goal was to build a platform upon which potential market consumers and service providers could function achieving the technology and platform development was linked to multiple entries and exits of specialists and providers, so that the realm of knowledge and creativity could be, in a way, internalized. With this happening, looking after the value management balance inside the ecosystem was essential in a way that all parties could also find a bail. One significant milestone here with them came with a survival challenge, typically in their fifth year, the famous fifth year, because at that time, Edmond was missing a valid business model. And they had to actually do something that, what from practitioner's perspective, we consider an experienced and confident, successful entrepreneur would do, and it is pivoting and iterating. Because so far they have been developing things directly for business to consumer, and here at this time, as they were at the level of non-survival, actually they shifted very successfully to B2B orientation, and they could survive and launch a viable product. Currently, they are in their growth phase, and the company is profitable, and the growth is partially catalyzed through big companies as clients and partners. At the current stage, they combine value capturing and value creation activities. And keeping up with the innovation side for a company and its ecosystem would mean, as suggested by Innovation 360 methodology, to sustain a system and level of value creation for growth in parallel with core business focus on short-term profitability. The difficulty here would reside in striking the right balance between growth and profit-related activities and splitting the resources. And the key word would be eventually ambidexterity, as Magnus Fenker explains in Sustainable Growth and Profits, among different leadership styles, strategies, competencies, and capabilities at three different levels, or otherwise we call them horizons. And engaging in simultaneous value capturing and value creation requires a kind of a strategic analysis encompassing, among others, a deep reflection upon strengths and blockages. So Edmond's most significant strengths are its core values, solid and aligned team and ecosystem, a very difficult to replicate and in-house built innovative artificial intelligence and more specifically natural language understanding technology, providing a high level of accuracy and spread of the data is another imminent strength of theirs. Additionally, they have a strong focus on impact. Their guiding question is how many people have been reached, as well as the flexibility in the product to reflect changing needs or other strengths of strategic importance. And their thinking about competition and competitors is somehow uncommon in a way. They practice what I have called no competitors thinking, which means that they collaboratively approach and treat every potential competitor and put in place collaborative settings, thus continuously actually enlarging the ecosystem. And this also allows them not to enter every possible solution and idea, even if there could be one with some financial potential, in case it is not the optimal one. And for example, they didn't enter, decided not to be directly involved in shopability development for their application. Edmond team developed the capacity also of participating in various incubators, accelerators, collaborations, and other forms of social knowledge and support. But more importantly, they have been learning how to access and enact this knowledge to reinvent continuously their value proposition. So they have been learning how, in keeping a significant level of flexibility in both their way of operating and their solution, and even more now when they're moving to much personalized options involving even more complexity and new level of dynamics. So far, actually, they had over 3 million foods tagged for chronic conditions in their database, and they are already moving towards mapping genotypes and microbiomes types to foods. Edamame's moonshot type solution attracted such established global companies as Microsoft, Amazon, and Nestle as their clients and partners. However, approaching these companies as clients and partners and setting up for the collaborations required thinking and acting that could align with the corporate world, as established brands often operate with a very strong focus on core business and in the short term are budget-led in their decision-making. And some takeaways here that the CEO, Victor Penev, shares as recommendations to young entrepreneurs and startups willing to build their ecosystem are following. First, taking a personal approach and interacting at the individual level to understand what the company aims at achieving and who actually does it, is involved with this within the company. The next is patience. In certain cases, it is necessary for the startups to wait for years, and here is where many would abandon eventually. So it would be nice to combine other activities with waiting for collaborating with established incumbents.
And Rika, Rika, can I interrupt you just one second? Yes. Hanadi, do we have one more paper that we have to get in? It's listed as two round tables. I'm not sure if there's another paper or not. So if you can wrap it up in the next couple of minutes, that'd be great. And then we'll have a little round table discussion for the last.
Yes, there is one more.
There is one more. Okay.
Yes, I think Professor Mike, there are Dr. Martina.
Okay. Yes. So there's one more paper left. So Igliki, if you can wrap it up in the next 10 seconds.
10 seconds is fine. And last but not least, being proactive in creating the opportunities for partnering. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you very much. And I apologize for having to cut you short. We're short of time here. Okay, let's squeeze in the last one. There's 7 minutes left. So Martinj Dreesen will have to talk a little quickly.
Please. Okay, well, that is the virtue of being last, of course. Let me share my screen.
It's my fault. I should have been better control of this. I apologize.
Just check. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Perfect. So thank you. A special thank you to Dr. Hanadi for inviting me again.
Hi, Martin. How are you? Nice to.
Hello, Dr. I'm very fine. Thank you. Thank you. So thank you very much. And also interesting about you, Ms. Michael. You talked about competencies. Creativity we had at the beginning, and we're going to talk about the entrepreneur. So especially about the entrepreneurial mindset. And let me go through it because there is a big problem, and it is still a problem, which is the high failure rates for startups worldwide. And if you look at the figures in the USA, I think you might know them. If you look at the screen, you see one big line with lots of lines. So those are cohorts. If you look at the number 5 at the bottom and you go up, you see it's about 50. So 50%. So 1 in 2 persons in the United States who starts a business is not in business after 5 years anymore. So, and it has been from early 2000 to up till now. So that is a big problem. But then of course you talk about USA. We all know that is a very entrepreneurial society. If we go across the Atlantic Ocean, we see in the European Union more or less the same. I want you to look at the number 5 years. So the blue bar, the dark blue bar, you see actually it's more or less, give or take, 50%. Some countries more, some countries less. I'm from the Netherlands, Amsterdam, and you can see it's about 50%. But also in several cohorts, it has been the same. In the previous talk, we heard Hilton Tunison from the South Africa saying actually 9 in 10 within 3 years. So there's a lot of money, there's a lot of effort is going into businesses, but yet 1 in 2 persons or even less don't make it. So there is something going on. So the question is, how is this possible? Of course, you can look at the business models. That's one thing. I was very interested, and that's why I started my PhD thesis into what about the entrepreneur? Actually, how does that go? If you look at this entrepreneurial model of entrepreneurial success, I'm not going to explain it. It's not a lot of time. What I want you to focus on is the orange surrounded. So that's the entrepreneurial traits and the business creation. There's a lot of research that actually tried to pinpoint the entrepreneurial traits directly to business creation, business success. It is possible. We are talking about alpha studies, so this is not exact science. Yet we see there are correlations, not high, but then again, for alpha studies, maybe it is. The more important thing, and that's what I want to stress out, and I want to show you how we do it, is if you look at the entrepreneurial traits, it's different from the personality, the broad personality like the DISC or the Big Five. We all know this is specifically about the entrepreneur. So what is the business person, the personality behind the business? And in this case, it's going through the goals and strategies. If you develop the entrepreneurial traits, you will get better goals and strategies, and you will get more business creation and business success. And we have done such research within the Netherlands, and I want to show you that. The question is, do you have these traits? Are you born with them? Is it in your blood? Do we need a blood test, or can you develop them? Another great scientific research has been done by some Swedish. They have looked at parents being adoptive or biological. And the most important thing here is you can develop entrepreneurship. It's not about genes. Are you born with the right genes? It's much more about upbringing and training. And in specific case, it is about coaching. But then again, how do you know when someone is entrepreneurial, yes or no? That is a big question. So what I would like you to do is, if you look at these two people, and this is, I think it's his wife, but maybe it's the secretary or maybe mistress, you don't know. They come from the bank and probably they did not get a good answer, or there is not a happy performance. But I would like to ask yourself, what do you think about this person? Is he entrepreneurial, yes or no? If you ask me, he doesn't look. But how do you know? Where do you look at? How do you know if someone is entrepreneurial? I asked the bank the same question, the bank, and actually they said it's gut feeling. Because if you look at what she says to him, it's like, of course you're not enterprising, I know that, you know that, but they don't know that because they have no instruments or tools to do that. And this is where my PhD started. I wanted to research, what is it about the entrepreneur? How do they assess it? How can you develop? How can you make sure that people gain the entrepreneurial mindset? They gain the creativity, as the first speaker talked about. Confidence, but also the social skills. Gloria and Yaya also told, which are, I think, very important, especially when you talk about value, creating values, making sure that other people see that too. So the solution, and this is where we got in, entrepreneurial assessment and development. What we have done is we've created a tool, which is the eScan. And actually eScan is a data-driven online scan where you compare yourself with others, other entrepreneurs, sexually, graphically, and you see the most important competencies. And it all takes place on the platform. And that is important because that's where the development takes place. I will show you later on. So it is a tool. And with every tool, you need someone to capture the tool, to really use the tool. The hammer doesn't build the apartment. So you need tools for being a good coach. And in this case, how can you match the person to the business and to the phases of the business? And for that, we have all kinds of innovative tools created, which is the making sure that people set the right targets, set the right goals, and how do you know which competencies to focus on? Because there are a lot, but some are very important for any business in any specific time. And then you need, of course, if you're the entrepreneur, you need a team around you. It doesn't have to be someone you hire. It can also be someone that you work with, or you have a good coach, or you have advisors, or if you have all kinds of things. So the coach is actually a very important person to make sure what type of person are you, and are you the good fit for the business you're in. So these are just some screenshots, very colorful, but this is where you get a great insight into who are you, what kind of type of person are you, and how well is your self-knowledge. All responsive, that's the main part here, what I want to say. Because what we also see in our research is that with the scan, the e-scan, we can measure the real entrepreneurial as a one figure from 0 to 100, how entrepreneurial are you. The more interesting thing is that we also find out with the people how well they think they score. So this is an estimated, and as you can see, these are averages for our total database over 1 million profiles, is that the entrepreneur more or less thinks 67.2, how entrepreneurial is, yet it is only 49.7. So there is a gap. They think they are entrepreneurial, but they're not, at least not in all competencies. So that's very important. And as I said, it's a tool. So you need coaches to actually access the tool and to reuse the tool to get the entrepreneur development really going on. And you have to start with the entrepreneur first. Now, to the research that we've done, and I'm also also in one of their two, three slides, so I'm almost ready. This is a program that we have done with the Chambers of Commerce several times in the Netherlands, about 2,800. What you see here is the first measurement and the post-measurement after a year. A full program with coaching, with knowledge, with training sessions, and also other network activities for social orientation, social skills, and things like that. Where you can see the orange line is the second one, and you can see that actually from self-belief on to creativity up to marketing, those are significantly grew significantly. And at the beginning, we have more traits. They grew, but not significantly yet. This is 1 year. And the interesting thing is what happens after that year. So almost gone. If you look at the growth rates after 5 years, we saw that at least in the European Union on average, but also in USA, about 49 are in business, 51 have to stop their business. With this growth program, and we look back for 5 years, it's 89% still in business, opposed to 11% not in business anymore. So that is a huge, and it's not all perfect, it's not all grown, not all unicorns, great companies or big companies, but at least they are still in business. And that's a huge way forward. So why should you start with the entrepreneur first? Because if you start talking about the business, it's difficult to start talking about the entrepreneur. It's actually like you left the train station and you're not going back to that station. So you have to start with the entrepreneur and do a pre and post measurement, because then you can show the growth to the person, the entrepreneur, but also to the contractor. Lower obstacles by also looking at entrepreneur talent. That's something that's still not done. Well, I think if they are getting coached, if they have certain skills you can rely on, why not also have that into the financing? Make use of informal institutions, networks. Professor Stamm has a great work on that. And of course, make sure you have a team. Make sure it's diverse. Make sure that the entrepreneur is encompassed by many talents, many knowledge, because you don't have to do it all on your own, even if you're a solo entrepreneur. And last but not least, and then I'm finished, the coach is a very important spider in the web. It's the glue that actually holds everything together, especially in ecosystems that we are talking about today. So thank you, and I hope I was on time. Now, maybe just a little bit more than that. So
thank you, Martin. That was an excellent paper. If we had a little more time, there's a lot of discussion we can have on this, but it was extremely well done. I want to thank you for the presentation. Hanadi, I apologize, I ran 4 or 5 minutes over.
Thank you so much, Professor Mike, for running the roundtable for the last sessions.